Who here has a copy of the Trinity College Harp or the Queen Mary Harp? Is that going to be
right?
Okay. What? You have an accordion? Mm-hmm. What note is the accordion?
G.
And what's your lowest note?
G.
Why do you have a setup like that?
G. It came that way.
Why did your harp make a setup like that?
Because of the box, when you make your harp, you have to make the wood sound on the G.
Why G?
On G.
Why the lowest string? Not the lowest string.
That's the way
the
18th century harpers.
That's the way the 18th century harpers had their big harp set up. They were calling it G. But they didn't stop and obviously below G, they carried on.
Yes.
But their harps were bigger. But, do you see what I mean? These are medieval harps, and you'll be using an 18th century idea to set them up. So my work, since the beginning of this year, really this is work I've been doing, for 10 years I've been saying, oh no, you should do this thing instead. Never did. At the beginning of this year, I had a student Trinity, it was away on rent on it, and came back, and I thought, at last, a chance to take all the strings off, change everything, and not risk, because I can't do that with my Queen Mary, like, it's my main instrument. So I did it on a student Trinity with no risk, and it works as well. Now I've done it on a Queen Mary as well. And now I'm recommending for everybody to have a medieval harp. Okay? So what this talk is going to present is, what is this deal, what's the rationale for it, and the justification behind it. So the Trinity College harp and the Queen Mary harp. And everybody knows these two. Okay? And this, we have two copies here. This is my replica, this is clone copying as exactly as possible, every detail of the original, as closely as I can manage, constantly tweaked as we discover new things from Karen's work. And this is one of Natalie's Connemara Trinities, a simplified student version, but presenting the measurements and the ergonomics of the real thing. So it works like the real thing, even though it's simplified. Okay? And so both of these are our standings for the two actual medieval harps that are in the museums. I was going to say without strings, the Trinity College Harp does have strings on over time in the 60s, and they're just there decorative now, they're not tuned for any pictures, and the Queen Mary Harp has no strings at all. And so there's this mission, and I've had this mission right from the beginning. There's the harps in the museum, and everyone says, oh, they're silent. Nobody will ever sound like. We can find out what they sound like, we can string them, we can play them, we can hear that medieval sound. But then there's this work, how do you string them? How do you tune them? Because if you string them and tune them wrong, you won't get the medieval sound. Okay? So this is my mission. These, we don't have exact dates of these. The Queen Mary harp, the artwork decorates the pillar to 1450, 1500. So we guess they're late medieval. So that's what I'm looking for, late medieval world. For evidence about harp stringing and tuning practice. We know they had metal strings all the way through in Ireland and Scotland. We know they need metal strings. Brass is the most common string material mentioned in other sources, glass. Other possible metals we can use are iron. There are iron strings in the treble of the mother mass. Silver. Some of us have silver strings in the base of our harp. And gold. Some of us have gold strings in the base of our harp. But these are the possible metals to use. Gold, silver, brass, and iron. They didn't have any other metals available in medieval times that could be used for making strings and stringing a harp. Not press it. Yes. So, 18th century was mentioned. So here's our 18th century evidence, and this is pretty cool that you can get the downhill harp here, never mind. You can get the downhill harp. Here's the range of notes on its 30 strings. And that's pretty explicit. And at the top, this is manuscript 29. This is Edward Bunting's field notebook, taken down in the field from Dennis of Hampstead. And he goes, C, D, E, G. Here's the gap in the bass. C, B, E, G, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, G. There's an accordion, the sister strings. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C, D as our highest string. Okay? He's numbered them in fives to show the count. The number of strings is 30. He's put F sharp in the key signature because he wants the harp to have F sharps. And so you have this scale. Here it is again, C, D, E, G. And so up he goes with F sharp in the key signature. There's a rule with the asterisk that you can shift this gap. There's all kinds of things going on there, but I'm not going to mention just now. You've clearly got a G thing going on. It's a kind of G home note at the harp with Macaulay. And G at the bass above the gap, and this string is called chronarm, the drone bass string. Okay? So these give the harp a G sonority, and you have F sharp. So it's a major scale with a sharp seventh. And everybody says to us, you can turn the F sharps down to F natural. So you can shift the harp from G major to G major and flat seventh. Some people would call that a mixolydian scale, but I think that's a silly word, so I'm going to use it. But it's a major scale with a flat seventh or a sharp seventh. So it's a major scale with a movable seventh, okay? And that's pretty clear from the 18th century evidence. And here's more from manuscript 29. We don't know which harp this is, but Ding sits down behind that, beside the harper, and says, show me how you tune the harp, and off the harper goes. So it says, scale of the harp, sharp key, or natural key. So, so this key is the sharp or natural key, both names, just to confuse you. F sharp, the key signature, sisters for Macaulay, and then here's your cycle of fifths and octaves to tune to set the temperament, cycle of four, a fourth to C, octaves up to the top. Eighths down, and then you have this when you get to bottom G, then you have a jump and you start doing a gap scale. And this is organ. I don't know what organ means. This is a mystery. He stops doing octaves and starts doing unison, but I'm ignoring that because that's too deep in the bass for us. That's the 18th century thing that we don't understand. Flat key or high bass. It starts with the sisters, F sharp in the key signature, G, sisters G, cycle of four, a fifth. Go back to G, cycle of four, a fourth from C to F natural. So although he's put F sharp in the key signature, this shows that it's a G major scale, but all the Fs are flat and accidentals. So this is the scale with flat sevenths. Octave up to the top, octaves down. And then the high bass thing is that the E in the bass goes up to F natural. So you turn your F sharp strings down to F natural, you turn your bass E up to F natural, and that's, so it shifts again, the bass gap. And so this is this funny little thing. And it doesn't seem to be consistent. There's tunes in the repertory that clearly require F naturals with E in the bass. So it's not consistent, this shifting of the bass, and there's issues to do with the names of the scales and how many different things we're allowed to do. But here's the kind of vague pattern. Does that make sense? This is the 18th century setup that we're using for studying the music of Arthur O'Neill and Dennis Hampsey and all that kind of thing. And those of you who have been in this early Irish harp scene for a while will be familiar with this way of tuning the harp and setting it up. Yes? Okay. Corley. It should be Nacorley, Nacorley. Translation, lying together is a bit suggestive. It's a bit obscene. And I think this is why the harpers would say the sisters. Because when you're speaking English to some music collector or gentleman patron, you don't want to be terribly suggestive and talk about the string to lie together. Called by the harpers, the sisters were two strings in unison, which were the first tune to the proper pitch. They answered to tenor G, fourth string on the violin, and nearly divided the instrument into bass and treble. This nearly is funny. Does it mean because it's not halfway down the half? Does it mean neatly? Is it missing from neatly? Or does it mean nearly because it's kind of a third of the way up? I don't know. But here's this evidence for Macaulay. And there's other evidence for Macaulay. Some people say, oh, it's not very well having the 18th century, but we don't have any earlier references to it. There was a number of references to unison strings in the middle of the half. The earliest, there's an early medieval one connected to Aaron Colin Kira, where there's the island without St. Columba after he died is like a church without an abbot. It's like a crutch without cage. Crutch is stringed instruments, and cage is, the early medieval commentators, they weren't quite sure, so in the glosses they got cage. Well, It's the name of the beach. It's the name of the little street. It's the name of the pit. It's the name of the bottom. It's the name of Corley. And so there's Corley appears in this kind of mad scour of attempts to define what the mystery word is. So it's not very useful. But there's a useful one. So this is attributed to an Irish poet from the 14th century. I cannot tune Corley, though I can tune many other strings with my tuning key. And there is his play on the suggestiveness of Corley and of tuning and of tuning keys and of holding the harp on the knee and fiddling with it and all this kind of thing. It's very obscene. It's great fun. But it's a really important early attestation of Corley in specifically in tuning the harp. I have issues with the language, like it should be. Why is it not Neodomi Nakorli? And there's all kinds of questions like that in the language scholars. We're mad for this one, but this is really interesting and important. Okay. So Nakorli, we have plenty of evidence of Nakorli in a harp tuning context, but we don't get told what it actually is until really into Bunting with his diagram and saying it's two G's. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay. Let's turn away from the harp and look at the mainstream. Remember, our target is the 15th century, the late medieval Gaelic harps. So let's turn our attention away from harps and general practice of medieval music. Who's familiar with this kind of thing? Has anyone ever seen this before? Take my mask on. So this is a paper copy of what's on the screen for you to enjoy. So on the left, I've given you a 15th century manuscript page for a music treatise. On the right, I have typeset for you, gloriously. Well, there's more than that. And if there's not, you'll share what between two, and I'll give you a share. But there should be enough, they're not enough. I'll make more, I'll make more of a multipliable door, as is my usual practice. Okay? So share for now, and you'll get more at the end. So this is just a type. Oh, here, something to this, because I can use the screen. So this is just a typeset version of that. So everything on here is copied neatly for you to read. Does that make sense? So this is a medieval world of music. Okay? So we start with gamma at the bottom. Gamma A B C D E F G A B. Two different types of B, C, D, E, F, G, A, B. Two different types of B, C, D, E. And that's all the possible notes in the universe. Okay? And you categorize them by these solmization symbols. Ut, ut, re, mi, fa, sol, la. You know this sequence? Okay, so you start on ut, re, mi, fa, sol, la. Or you can start here. Ut, re, mi, fa, sol, la. Or you can start here. Ut, re, mi, fa, sol, la. And you can sing any possible tune of any range within this universe by jumping from one to the next. Okay? And the way you jump is you go ut, re, mi, fa, sol, like that. And so it's sol, mi, which is why it's called solmization. It's all canon stuff, Okay, now this introduces very interesting things. So ut to re is a tone, re to mi is a whole tone. Mi fa is a semitone. Mi fa is the semitone in the scale. So ut re mi fa sol la. So gamma ut a re b mi si fa d sol e la. And then we go si ut d re e mi f fa G sol A la, and then we go F F ut G re A mi B fa. Okay? So we have B, B, Fa. And then if we start here, we go G, Ut, A, Re, B, Mi. And there's a difference between B, Fa and B, Mi. And what is that difference? Anyone tell me what the difference between B, Fa and B, Mi is?
B flat
and B natural. And you'll see how the manuscript writes around B for B flat, like a flat sign, and a square B for B natural, like a natural sign. So this is where our flat and natural signs come from. Okay, so in the medieval world, you go G, A, B, C, G. You can only have B natural at the bottom, because how can you generate B flat? You can't, because you're not allowed to start below the bottom of the universe. So it goes G, A, B natural, C, D, E, F, G, A, B flat, B natural, C. But B flat and B natural are kind of versions of the same thing. They're not standalone independent notes in the scale. Does this make sense? If you have any questions, please say. This diagram, every possible note in the universe is in this diagram. There is no note below gamma root. It's like the centre of the world. And there is no note above double E la, because that's like the distant heavens. You can't go beyond them. That's it. Nowadays, you can have anything that we want. You can have like super double triple G that goes boom, boom, boom. We're not allowed to do that in medieval times, because gamma root is the fundament, it's the beginning of the universe. Does that make sense? It's a world that's very clearly defined in this way.
Can I ask a question?
Yes?
But you know no T.
No, that was invented later.
Alright.
Okay, that was a later addition. This is the original system.
Okay.
Yeah. So like a gap scale?
No. It's not a gap scale, because there's no gap. It's just that it starts here and stops here.
Oh.
Okay. To carry on, you jump to the next one and then you can carry on.
Okay.
Yeah? So there's no gap. It's just six notes. It's called a hexachord. Is anybody happy with that? You understand that this is the complete range of medieval notes. Okay? Turn your papers over. Does anyone understand this picture?
Yes.
I think this is really cool that medieval world, we still use it every day when we work with music today. Here's gamma root from the manuscript. And here's the bottom line. What's this?
Or that's not the G flat. Sorry, that's the F.
It's just a letter F. It's just a letter F on the cliff. And what's this?
That's G.
It's a letter G on its line. And it, who knows alto and tenor clefs? To the letter C. If we go back one. Our medieval man has helpfully written here. Here's a C clef on the C line, here's a G clef on the G line, and here's the F clef on the F line.
Oh.
Okay. So I think that's so cool. So that's a little aside, but this helps you understand. This is the medieval world of music with the B flat and the B natural. Okay? Now, looking at foreign harps, here's Agricola's book from 1529. And it's a music treatise, and he writes, the tablature of the harp. The tablature applied to the harp. This is what he says. And so he's written letters. He's very naughty, because he's after medieval times. Okay, he's into the Renaissance, after medieval times, you can be as naughty as you like. He's got double F at the bottom, and that's just like right out. But he's allowed to do it because he's post-medieval. So he's got double. So here's G. He's also very naughty because he's got B flat and B natural. So because it's German, they write H for the square B natural and B for the round B flat. So he goes F, G, A, double B, C, D, E, F, G, A, B flat, B natural, C, D, E, F, G, A, B flat, B natural, C, D, E, F, G, A, B flat, B natural. So he goes too high as well. So you can see what he's done. He's taken the medieval gamut concept. Did I say this was called the gamut? Because it starts at gamma as root. So this is called the gamma, this map of the world. So he's taken the medieval gamma roots and he's just extended it top and bottom to be a bit pushing the boundaries. Okay? But it's an obvious way to set up a medieval harp, isn't it? With gamma. Of course you have medieval gamma notes on your harp, don't you? Don't you?
Yes, we can.
So on your harp you have GA. Not C sharp, not G sharp, not F sharp, because those are not part of the medieval world, but B flat and B natural. Yes?
Just not.
Let's look in a completely different direction, okay? We're used to having, when we say G, we mean a specific pitch. If I'm half a note higher, that's not G, that's G sharp, yeah? That's what we would normally say. But it's normal around the world in historical times to say, if you're half a note higher, that's fine, that's G as well. It's just G half a note higher, or G half a note lower, yeah? Is everyone happy with this concept? Nowadays we call it pitch standard. If your G is half a note lower, it's not F sharp, it's G at a pitch standard of A415. Are you aware of this concept? It's normal for harpsichords and lutes and recorders to be at a pitch of A415. And what this means is that they play G, and we listen and we think, it sounds like F sharp to me. But it's not F sharp, it's G bumped down half a note. It's a lower pitch standard, yes? So you can have any pitch standard you like. Some people are using French pitch now, which is a whole note lower. So you play G on your lute, and it actually sounds like F natural. And some people are using higher pitch. So you play G on your lute, and it sounds like G sharp. So you can have all kinds of different pitches. And we still get traces of that nowadays in the modern orchestra. For example, a trumpet. If you ask an orchestra trumpet player to play C, he picks up his trumpet and blows it open, because trumpets are usually, C is the open open trumpet, and everyone else listens and says E flat, because the trumpet is a semitone lower than everybody else. And the French horns are normally E flat is the note they play for C. So there's lots of different woodwind instruments, and there's lots of different stuff going on nowadays in orchestra. And people just think that's fine. You say the trumpet is in B flat. And the French horn is in E flat because it plays C but speaks a different pitch to everyone else's C's. Yes? Everyone follow this? What happens when you come across a harpsichord set up like this?
It's a double manual
harpsichord. It's a double manual harpsichord. So you can play the top manual and you can play the bottom manual. So
it's a volume control thing, isn't it?
Well, where's the middle C? Which thing on this harpsichord is the middle C?
The one in the middle.
maybe this one. Okay, we go down to the other manual. This is not C. Okay, it's this middle C, but so if I wanted to tune my harp, I said, could you give me the G below the C, please? And then go which one? Because there's more than one. And there are four harps. And this was not uncommon. It was quite normal in churches for the choir and the organ to be a fourth part. So the organist would have to transpose all the time. So this was normal in Renaissance times. It was quite common. Okay. So one of our evidences for the Corley is James Talbot's manuscript, where he inspects and measures and describes a couple of Irish harps in Cambridge in England in 1690. And he describes how they're made, and he describes the number of strings, and he says, you tune it from the top, gradually down, and when you get to the middle, you insert them in unison. And these two are called a wolf. The wolf should be about C or G. Okay. So what does he mean? That you can put them in different places? Or does he mean, well, depends which way, which keyboard of the harpsichord you press? Or does he mean, you, you strike these two sort of Macaulay strings, and you say to the harper, what note's that? And he says, C.
G.
Okay, and thinks very well count. This is normal, okay? This is normal in Renaissance and early rock music. I have no problem with this at all. Do we? Yeah?
This man was talking about C, it's the C note for us. Or it's
we don't know, it could be
any
pitch standard.
C like in medieval.
It could be any pitch standard. We don't this is the point. C, G,
yes.
Could be at any. So I thought, we need to get a handle on this C and G, two pitch standards and fourth apart, and we don't know what their level is. Okay? And so I had a quick thought and I thought we could go. You can have any pitch that you like, but let's give ourselves a constraint arbitrarily. So this is my chart that I've made up. Okay, and here we have that one, it's more, it's a share. So what this chart does is it gives you different dispositions for a Gaelic harp with Macaulay at C or G. So this is the absolute speaking pitch. This is the absolute speaking pitch of Macaulay, and these are the modern note names at A440. And so most of the harps here are set up on this stack. Here is G at 196 hertz. And our pitch standard, A440. Does that make sense? Just this column, does that make sense? You understand what I'm doing? So so here, I'll give you an example. Macaulay, G, 196 hertz. A-dash, 440 hertz. Yes? You're happy with that, okay? If I were to call this note C, middle C, middle C, middle C, G, D, F, G, A, A330 hertz. So that's a pitch standard of A330. Okay. Does that make sense?
So A to G.
This is middle C.
Middle C.
C, D, E, F, G, A. There's A at 330 hertz. Yes?
So middle C comes between A at the top and G below, is that right?
I'm not talking about G below at the moment, I'm talking about C. Middle C, middle C, D, D, F, G, A. A 330 hertz. Or I can switch my head and go, no, I was wrong. G, G, A, B, C, D, E, E, F, G. A440. So it gives me two different labels for the note names. Okay, the note names are not fixed, they are arbitrary, and I'm shifting them in my head to use different names for the notes. Yes? Yes?
So.
It's like going on the street and saying, I'm the third house on the street. And so you go to the corner and you go 1, 2, 3, and you realize, actually there's another corner further along. So you go to that corner and you go 1, 2, 3. Right. If you count it from the first corner, it would be the 13th. But it's not. It's do you see what I mean? It's a different ways of counting.
So the, say, G could actually be
like,
you go along to C.
I haven't touched the tuning of the harp. I haven't retuned the harp. I've only moved the labels in my head.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Okay, so I'm not, the half is identical, but my head is different.
Yeah.
But is the are the positions of the two G's constant?
I haven't touched the half.
I know, but in the scale of things, are they
right? They are not, because I could set the half up here instead.
All right.
Okay, and I could have the two G's a semitone higher.
So it depends.
And then my pitch standard would be 4-6-6.
So it depends on how it's strung.
Yeah, how it's tuned. Or it could be a whole tone higher, and I could have my G's at 220, or C at 220, And then my pitch standard would be 494 or 370. Yeah? Or he could go in a little bit higher. And I could have my C's and G's at 233. And my pitch standard would be 523 or 392, depending on whether I call it C or G. Or I could go higher again, and I could have my C and G at 247 hertz, really getting squeaky and high now. And then my pitch standard would be 550 or 415. Now we're back in familiar territory, now we're back at 415. And yet it's 415 hertz with an equality at C. Oh. Or I could bump it a semitone higher and I could have my C and G at 262 hertz. And then my pitch standard is 587, awfully squeaky. Or 440. Oh, how convenient. Okay? So of course you could then bump it even a note higher, you get even squeakier. Or you could bump it even a note lower. Siobhan has her Malamas bumped a note lower here. She has it here, G down here. And her pitch standard is 415 or 311. But nobody would ever think of a beat rock harp in there before in little C, so you'd let her get away with it. But the earlier you go, the more likely you are, I think, to think you can call it a little C. Okay. Is everybody happy with this? Does this kind of make sense? Does this kind of make sense?
Yeah. It's making my brain dizzy.
But it's designed to make your brain dizzy. It makes my brain dizzy. This is why I draw diagrams. It took me hours and hours to come up with this diagram and try and get order onto the world. So you have to remember that the harp is fixed, it's the labels in your head that are shifting. But then you're allowed to shift the harp. And the labels in your head have to shift with it. That they can also shift independently.
Okay.
So you need to get a grip on what shift, what you're moving and what you're fixing the same. Okay? It's not easy. Okay, here we are, 2003. And I was loaned this harp. This was the first harp I ever had as a kit I made myself. It was basically a lever harp. And then I was loaned this harp, a fairly good measured copy of the Queen Mary harp. And I had to string it myself because it came with no strings at all. And so I thought, how do you set up a medieval harp? Well, you have the gamut. The bottom of the gamut is gamma. Oops. So G is the lowest note. And I thought, you have to have Macaulay. And Macaulay is a G, and that's an octave above gamma root. Oh, how marvellous. So off we went, and there's the harp set up. And that's how most people are still setting up their Queen Mary harps today. And I probably wasn't the first to do this. I'm sure Anne did it before me, because everything that I do always, Anne's done it already. Here we are in March 2005, looking terrifyingly young and naive. And,
very blurry.
In the 2004 summer school,
the conflict.
There was only three copies of historical harps.
In 2005, I'm sure you know where to make it. In 2005, I had my still strong copy at the school, yes, because that was my first school.
But in 2004, there were only three copies of historical harps at the summer school. Everybody else had modern wire-strung instruments. And the three historical harps were my funny old Queen Mary, and Siobhan's Trinity, and Trinity. And we thought, this is not acceptable. We can't do a historical music summer school using modern instruments. And so we commissioned David Courtier to make student Trinity harps. And these were the first batch that he delivered in March 2005. And we strung them using my C, with gamma root at the bottom of the harp, and the Macaulay G, and F sharp and F natural. With silver bass strings and brass trebles, and there they are. Just not even all strung, because these ones at the front. Look, this one's got coils of wire still tangled around the soundboard.
Jim. Is in the picture.
That building fell out of the range.
And Siobhan's standing in the middle, looking like a teenager. And me looking like a hippie. So this scheme was used ever since, really?
Yeah.
What are the problems with this scheme? There's two big problems with this scheme from my point of view that have been nagging at me for years. One, it doesn't have to be flat. It has F sharp. That's not right. That's not right for medieval music. That's not right for medieval harp. And yet it doesn't make sense to turn the B's flat because then it interferes with where the calling is. It doesn't fit with it. You want your shifting string to be below the calling. Next to the calling, to the sharp seventh, the flat seventh, the scale. And if you have a calling G and you turn B flat, you're not getting a sharp and flat seventh. So that doesn't make sense. The harps don't speak as well as they could. The trebles are under tension. If you have an accurate copy, the trebles are slack and dull. And people cheated. Okay, I cheated. That this harp, I didn't know it, but the trebles were longer.
Yeah, that's the same in my harp.
And therefore it speaks better than treble. Some people cheat. People cheat. David Cortick, I don't think he cheated, he didn't have the right information. But Anne's and Chabon's trinities, the trebles are much longer than they should be, so they speak well at this pitch. But if you have the trebles long, so you can pitch them low, the basses are also short, and you have gold strings. So it makes sense to have a set up with brass trebles, and long brass trebles speaking well, and gold basses that speak well. Okay? But I think that's not right, you know. If the trebles are right, they're too short, it doesn't speak well. What you do? And so I had all kinds of questions. I thought, if you try different kinds of method, if you get historical brass, it's weak. Or I ran silver all the way up to the treble. And Jane has her harp set up like that, with silver all the way to the treble. And the silver treble speaks well, because now the short trebles are to pitch that they work well. But it still has F sharps and F natural, it doesn't have B flats. You see what I mean? These two problems kept nagging at me, and I couldn't think what to do. And then eventually I thought, can't we put everything together? You have an accord at C, you turn the harp up a little bit, and it all works. And so this is the scheme I come up with. And this diagram shows you my scheme that I came up with, and it also shows how this new scheme relates to the 18th century scheme. Because I thought I also want to respect the 18th century tradition. I don't just want to arbitrarily make up a tradition. The 18th century tradition is important, something to understand it, because it is the direct descendant of the medieval traditions. So the idea of this chart is it shows you the relationship between the medieval gamut, the 18th century Irish harp tuning, and a kind of halfway house that might respect both and give us a possible setup for a medieval harp. So do you see how it works? Here's our medieval gamut that we know and love. Gamma, A, B natural, C, D, E, F, G, A, B flat, B natural, C, D, E, F, G, A, B flat, B natural, C, D, E. So what was I looking for? The movable seventh. Here's the movable seventh. The fact that note at the bottom octave has a problem is that it can't move. Well, look, there's funny stuff going on here. It's not the same funny stuff, but it's funny. Do you understand what I mean? This is the bit I'm least happy with. It's funny, but it's not the same. But you can match it. And then, if you think, here's the movable seventh, here's the movable seventh, well, this is obviously the direction to go, yeah? So here's our movable seventh on one string that can go up and down, and then the next one up has to be the Corley in middle C. And then you go down an octave to bass C. This could be Cronan C, which is equivalent of Cronan G. And then you have your gap to avoid the whole question of what you do here when you're not allowed to retune. Because I couldn't cope with putting B flats in the harp but having B natural in the bass. I couldn't cope with that. It's not happening. So you have a gap, and then you have strings below. And they match the strings below on the 18th century harps. Okay? And then you go up. And then this is a problem. So you get to top E, and then you think, well, that's it, that's the end of the world. You fall off the edge. And yet the harp has 9 more strings on it than that. And so this is a bit I don't understand. So just go super high. You know? And yet, going super high kind of works. It makes sense. So I thought all this, I thought, well,
It's lovely. What next? Well, see, the whole point of being here is that we're doing performance-based research and research-based performance. So you have to do it. If you've got a medieval harp, you have to do this. There's no escape. Yeah. So there we are. We're going to have a floor. Yes, go ahead.
What is the difference between the Baroque harp and medieval Irish harp?
This is a medieval Irish harp.
Yeah.
Okay. This is a Baroque Irish harp. They're not the same.
Yes.
Yeah, they're completely different things. I mean, they're not completely different, they're in connections, but they're not the same thing at all. That's what I mean. Yeah. So I thought I have to do it. And it was when my student Trinity came back to my house and nobody was renting it. Here it is. And I did it, and it worked. And I thought, it works. Bravo, as they say. So I have to do it to here as well. So here we are. So here's an accord E at middle C. I've got B natural at the moment, sharp seventh. Go down. Pronoun C. And then two below.
You have 30 strings
here. I have 30 strings on my heart, yeah. Because it's a composite replica.
Sorry, can you just clarify the original on that part? What was the original album?
Nobody knows. Nobody knows. That's what this research is for.
Yeah.
This is what we're trying to find out.
Okay.
And so here it is on the Trinity. Natalie sent this one up for me, especially for this lecture. Thank you very much, Natalie.
I didn't
choose
that.
I did.
Okay.
So here's an accordion with a C. Go up to top G, but look, that's the same as D on the downhill harp, which is the top note of the downhill harp.
But your harp has an E.
My harp has 30 strings, and so it goes up to E at the top. But we know that some of the 18th century Irish harps don't have as high as E. Siobhan has the Muller Mast, the E is as high as E. That's the reason she has it at 415, is because she wants the top E, because Caroline uses it.
Okay.
Nobody uses top F, doesn't appear in any of the repertory. So that's the top limit, and look how it matches the top limits of this new disposition.
So, I mean,
originally changed it, what difference does it make to your playing the repertoire?
The harp sounds so much better. So this is what my Monday talk is about. Once you've all restrung and retuned your harps, you can come along on Monday and we'll talk about what music do we play on this medieval centre.
It's like
is there a problem with this? Is there any problems? Any objections?
What about considering?
Never mind. Yeah, go on.
I'll wait. I have
stupid problems and objections are even more welcome because that allows me to demolish them.
Well, don't we know that, pitch standards varied so widely? There were medieval organs where it's like A4, A5.
By all means, play the note, drop the note. That's fine. I'm looking for the ballpark area.
It's like we either restrict
or cut
nails.
But yeah.
I was just going to ask if you have any suggestions as to why the harp down goes that much further than the medieval garret.
I don't know. I wonder. The medieval garret is a vocal range for monks to sing, and it's basically the range of the human voice. Okay? Now, I wonder if that higher range is connected to instrumental variations, bigger geometric variations, like if my name rolls up you or in John Moore.
Because
you can do really intense instrumental meditative sounds high up there that you can't sing. You could equally ask why they didn't go lower than the gamut instead of higher, but I wonder if gamut, which is more fundamental a stop than double E lab. And I also think it's harder to make harps go low than it is to go high.
Sorry?
Just from a theological point of view, wouldn't the heavens be more of a cutoff than the earth?
The center of the earth is more fundamental because you can go transcendental, you can go beyond the heavens into some kind of existential realm. You can't go further, you can't go lower than the center of the earth.
And I don't know much about IQ, but aren't there sharp tunings referenced in IQ?
Nobody knows anything about what was IQ's tuning. Nobody actually knows anything, it's just
Simon.
Yes.
So, if there was a change that occurred, when do you suppose that it would have changed? And when you get to the post-Baroque, the cutting was clear.
At this point, it becomes wildly speculation. But I wonder if this is the medieval world, this is the Renaissance world, and this is the Baroque and modern world. I'm wondering if that's the kind of timescale: medieval, Renaissance, Baroque. But that's pure supposition. There are pieces of evidence to support that. So there's suggestions from Renaissance music scholars that dual pitch standard of the harpsichords is about here. We know that the Baroque pitch standard tends to be off this end. Yeah. And there's another thing. I'm interested in the connection between the harp and the Scottish Highland bagpipes. Now the Scottish Highland bagpipes, they have a chance to play the tune. I'll use the other harp to demonstrate. They're chanting to play the tune, and they have three drones that stick up over the pipe's shoulders. One, two, three. One long one, and two short ones. Okay, the two short ones are about that piece, they're actually about a semitone lower. The big one is at this pitch. Okay, so an accordion chroma. And the scale of the pipes is this scale. But a note lower than this. So the bagpipes exactly match the harp. That's about here, in this area. That's where the pipes live. And they've been like that since the 18th century or before, late 17th century. Okay? So my suggestion is if you want to set up a Trinity or Queen Mary harp, you put it here. If you want to set up a Lamont harp, I would suggest here would be a good place to set it up. If you want to set up an 18th century harp, you put it here.
Okay.
That's what I would suggest. We're basically done, aren't we? We're basically done. If anyone wants to try any of these two harps, you're more than welcome. The Trinity is currently tuned with B flat, and Queen Mary is currently tuned with B natural, but you're welcome to retune them. Or you're welcome to ask a person who knows how to tune to each other. Okay? I appreciate your opinions and feedback on them as you like.
What did he do exactly?
What I did, okay, to redo my Queen Mary harp, what I did was I made all the strings thinner and higher in pitch. So the tension is about, the tension is the same. The tension on the wood frame is the same, but each string is thinner and higher in pitch. So it speaks much better. Really sweet and mean. And I also took all the gold strings off it, and it now has silver all the way down to the bass. And this is one of my questions for you. Is this okay? Because there's been people who've gone on for ages and have little gold bases on your harp, you can get away with silver. So we have glass, silver. That's not so nice. That's disgusting. So at the moment I think, but this is pronoun. This is your main drone note. What do you use these two for? Special effects? Do they need to sound lovely? Are you playing them? You want to like that? And we were talking about this earlier on with the bass of the Muller Mast and the Rose Mooney. They go a lot lower. Perhaps I'll use a Rose Mooney because it sounds even tubbier. So listen to these basses. They're not very good, are they? But we were looking at the scores earlier. They're not. Arthur O'Neill doesn't seem to be playing his bass individually. He's playing them as octaves. And the octave doubling covers the muted bass sound. So I'm wondering, do we mind that the bass is a bit tubby? Do we mind those two below chroma are a bit tubby? Or do we want to get gold onto them to make them really rich and pure? And at the moment, I don't know. And I've deliberately not put my gold back on because I wanted you guys to see and hear the harp with silver basses and tell me what you think. Because I don't know. I don't know if I just want to get back to gold or if I want to stick with their tubbiness to understand. Because it's to do with understanding the music. If the bass is more tubby, it leads you to double the octaves and not playing the single notes. And that affects your. Do you know what I mean? I don't want to just. Oh, yeah, it does make good. Put gold on. Sorted. Because. I want to understand the ancient tradition. I don't just want to impose my own aesthetic onto the harp. The tradition is bigger than me, so I want to respect it and understand it.
I'd like to try yours.
I was going to say form an order with you, but I thought it would be more fun to just have a rally. So. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You would have to keep the main at least several different types of harp for the different types of music.
Oh yeah.
What happens if you
want to? So Paul has just made an interesting suggestion. He says, how do you play caravan on the flute? You can say that. You know, I say, how do you play caravan on my harp?
You don't.
And the answer is, I don't know. How do you play caravan on it for? I mean, you may as well, I can't play stay up in heaven on that harp. I mean, you can if you want, but that's not what it's for, okay? You can, feel free. But that's not what it's designed for. That's not my privacy setting up. So I don't care that there's now a mismatch between the medieval harps and the rock harps. I don't care that it's now going to be difficult to have a mixed class with people turning up with medieval harps to study Arthur O'Neill's arrangements. That's fine. In fact, that's better than people turning up with medieval harps and studying Arthur O'Neill's arrangements and thinking that that's cool and there's nothing wrong with that. Okay, it's fine. They're not meant to be the same. So yeah, if you want to play medieval tunes and rock tunes, again, medieval harp and rock harp, easy.
And
I
buy two seats instead of one.
You know? Sorry,
happy. Would you choose the 18th century harps and perhaps the Italian as well, or perhaps when you're saying wire-strung or wire-strung?
It's not a retuning; it's a relabeling. So the other thing about this harp, let me take this one. Listen. Can anybody tell me what the name of that note is?
Cowley.
What letter name is it?
C.
Okay, you can go to the bottom of the class. Anybody else have any suggestions?
C or G.
C or G, you can go to the middle of the class. If you say G, you go to the top of the class. This could be C or G. So G, G, A, B, middle C, middle C, D, E, F natural, G. So that's an awfully squeaky high pitch standard, but it does. It's fine. So if you want to play a tune that has F sharp, and that has a G resonant drone, because it's a Renaissance sort of tune, you can squeeze it on by playing it in a squeaky high pitch standard. So that's how you play caramel on the middle of your harp. It's squeaky high. Of course it's squeaky high. Look how much smaller the harp is than the caramel harp. But the real answer is you need two harps.
Yes, I know.
If you want to study this, then you have two harps. Yes, it's been time you can't
see it at the moment. That's
I told
me
I needed a small. No, it's not.
Brenda.
I'm an editor. I think it's a good to pass more.
Or else, would you?